100 years ago, Britain's greatest national event was stopped in its tracks by a very public, very shocking, and ultimately fatal act of protest. At the height of the 1913 Epsom Derby, in front of thousands of spectators, a lone figure walked into the path of the galloping horses. What happened next was captured on film in horrific detail. The woman in this footage was Emily Wilding Davison.
She was a suffragette, and she climbed underneath the running rail into the path of the King's horse.
I want to investigate the mysteries that still surround Emily's death. Using the latest forensic techniques to analyse the newsreel footage, I'm hoping it can reveal her intentions that day. Was it suicide? Or a protest that went tragically wrong?
That is amazing.
And I'm going to dig deep into Emily's life story to work out what drove a middle-class governess to carry out such a desperate act. Along the way, I'll uncover a hidden history of violence by women prepared to use almost any means in their fight for the vote.
We're talking about a terrorist movement. Bombing, burning.
And reveal just how far the state was prepared to go to suppress them.
This is a cover-up, and this document here is a lie.
On Derby Day, June the 4th, 1913, a horrifying act was captured on three newsreel cameras. It transformed 40-year-old activist Emily Davison from a bit part player in the Votes for Women campaign into perhaps the most famous suffragette of all.
There's so much historically that I don't know and that I need to understand, that I need to imagine, if I'm to get a full grasp of what happened on that Wednesday in June in 1913.
I was brought up to believe that Emily Davison deliberately threw herself under a horse, but it was pure chance that it was owned by the King. The surviving evidence is not clear-cut. Emily left no note, and in her purse was a return train ticket. This doesn't suggest someone who wanted to take her own life. So after a century of mystery surrounding her intentions, I want to re-examine the only concrete evidence we have. With a team of forensic investigators, I'm going to look again at the newsreel footage to finally reveal what Emily was attempting to do. Mike Dixon and Stephen Cole have been expert witnesses at 300 murder trials. Using the latest forensic techniques, they'll examine each frame anew. We'll start by seeing if there are any clues in one of the camera angles.
Have a look at this.
Oh. It's a shocking thing to watch, even in grainy old film.
Yeah.
It still has the power to go, you know, to make you rock back, because you just, you know.
You can see various objects.
Yeah, her hat goes
Leave her, going, yeah, they certainly can see that.
One particular object has caught their eye. Yeah.
See the white?
Yeah.
If you follow the white, it comes away from her.
Oh,
it's
yeah.
definitely attached to her or from her person at point of impact.
I've always believed that it was pure chance that Emily collided with the King's horse, Anma, ridden by Herbert Jones.
When you look at this footage, even I can pick out the King's colours, because every other jockey has light colours and the royal colours are very dark. And she's got out there so quickly.
I've described it as with purpose, because she does seem to think she knows where she's going.
Normally, you see, a horse will do anything it can to avoid a human being or another horse. That comes down with a really major thud. And I just can't work out
She wouldn't have been strong enough to pull it. I don't know. I don't know.
The forensics team begin their work analysing the film footage. It's existed for 100 years, but this is the first time it has been subjected to such in-depth analysis. They're hoping to uncover something new.
Can you see what I mean?
Yeah.
Everything lines up.
It changes everything.
While Steve and Mike focus on the moment of Emily's death, I'm going to investigate the woman herself and try to understand who she really was. Emily's story has acquired the status of myth in horse racing circles, so before I try to separate fact from fiction, I'm going to get the official racing version from my family. They've been involved in racing for generations. In 1971, the year I was born, my father trained a horse called Mill Reef to win the Derby.
Do you think, Dad, it is possible for a person to target one animal and try to bring it down?
No. I don't think it's possible. I mean, I think she must have just been lucky, or the horse unlucky, because she might have known the colours, but you wouldn't see them till they'd gone by, would you?
Well, it's interesting.
She was right on Tatton Corner, so she had no chance of seeing, did she? When you see where she came from.
Yes.
But at 35 miles an hour or whatever, not a hope. They're coming off the brow of the hill. Yeah. She would have seen them just as they hit her.
Well, she'd hardly seen them. You know, the crowds at Tatton Corner are huge, aren't they?
There's sort of mixed reports that she might have practiced this, that she was seen on the gallops trying to grab the reins.
Well, and stick something on. Didn't she have some flags in her bag or something?
There's also this, in the pictures, we think there might be something that she's got with her.
That's her.
Yeah.
Right, and that's the jockey.
Yeah.
And he was all right, wasn't he, the horse?
Yeah, the horse was all right.
She didn't go there with the intention of killing herself, obviously.
You either take the evidence of the return ticket and you say, and a holiday booked, I think, the week after, and say, no, she
and
didn't intend to.
And the suffragette ball that night.
Oh, was it that night, was it?
I think so, yeah.
God, that would have been a blast.
Don't you start being disparaging about the suffragette movement, Andrew Balding. This is the world I grew up in.
Well, it's just challenging.
Women ain't people.
Challenging.
Yeah, why would you give a woman the vote? My God.
Despite the world I grew up in, I can understand why Votes for Women was such a huge cause. But what was it that so radicalised a middle-class governess, born in London in 1872, that she was willing to put her life in danger? Her education may have played a part. Royal Holloway College in Surrey was founded by entrepreneur Thomas Holloway and his wife Jane. They wanted to promote education for women when educational opportunities for women were almost non-existent. Here, I'm meeting author on the suffragettes, Fran Abrams. She's been looking into Emily Davison's connections to the college.
So, there she is, Davison Emily Wilding. She came in January 1892, but only a year or so later her father died. It became apparent soon afterwards that the family finances were not in a great shape. So Emily had to leave. And yet, she didn't give up on her education. She went to work as a governess and she carried on working for her exams. And in 1895, 2 years after she left here, she got a first class degree. And then 12 years after that, in 1908, she got her honours. So that's how determined she was, you know. She wasn't a woman who gave up easily once she had set her mind to something. I think that's what I'd say about her.
How did she get involved in the suffragette movement?
Yeah, well, we don't know an awful lot about that, but I've been looking through the registers and I found something really interesting, which is you find here, you see, left in July 1893, same time as Emily, Louisa Martindale. Now, Louisa Martindale was the daughter of a quite prominent women's suffragist. So Emily, when she was here, certainly had contemporaries who were very much engaged with the fight for the vote.
When Emily was at Royal Holloway, the Votes for Women campaign had been in existence for 30 years. It was still trying to negotiate the vote by constitutional means, but nothing had yet been achieved. This led in 1903 to the founding of the Women's Social and Political Union. The WSPU advocated more direct action to agitate for the vote. The leading lights in this new organisation, nicknamed the Suffragettes, were the remarkable Pankhurst family. Emmeline Pankhurst and her daughters Christabel and Sylvia were central to the organisation. In 1905, Christabel was arrested for disrupting a speech by the Liberal politician Sir Edward Grey and for spitting at a policeman. It was the first act of militancy. Emily Davison chose to join this more radical arm of the Votes for Women campaign in 1906. Within a few years, their methods had changed beyond recognition. To show how radical the suffragettes became, Fran has brought along a newspaper report from 1913.
Militant suffragists' outrages. The mutilation of works of art and the placing of bombs in or near public buildings, the losses through incendiarism being already estimated at some £384,000. I mean, that's millions.
Yes, I think in today's money that would be about £30 million. So it's an enormous sum of money. Yeah. So, and you can see, you know, all over the country, from Scotland to the south of England, you know, buildings were being burned and blown up.
We're talking about a terrorist movement, bombing, burning, obviously frequent arrests. And I think I rather underestimated it.
I've been shocked by the violent militancy of the suffragettes and intrigued by my first viewing of the footage. With 21st century forensics on the case and a hidden history emerging, I suspect there are more surprises to come. I want to find out what propelled Emily Davison through the ranks of the militant suffragettes to become their most celebrated martyr. Emily joined the suffragettes in 1906, just as the organisation was becoming more radical. In 1908, she was a marshal at a protest in Hyde Park that attracted as many as 700,000 people. But the establishment still ignored the movement's demand for votes for women. Snubs like this further radicalised suffragettes like Emily. Her focus now shifted from official duties to clandestine militancy. In 1909, she was arrested for the first time, trying to storm the House of Commons. But in 1910, the suffragette leadership suspended all militant action when it looked as if the government might finally act. But when the suffrage bill was abandoned, a group of protesters marched on the Houses of Parliament, hoping to provoke a reaction. What they got became known as Black Friday, one of the darkest and most controversial days in suffragette history. Catherine Connolly, chair of the Emily Davison Memorial Campaign, wants to show me the official account held in Parliament.
Well, this is the police report about what happened on Black Friday. That's what they called the day because it was so horrific.
So handwritten, beautifully written, actually. Oh, here. The disorder was caused by both women and men belonging to their union, and that's the... and were dealt with by police on duty in the streets. Very disorderly conduct, obstruction to police, assaults on police, etc., and some cases of window smashing by females. Altogether, 117 arrests were made. Wow. All passed off quietly inside the building. Now, is that... That is the official police report.
Yeah.
Are you saying that your evidence suggests that is not a correct... reflection of what happened?
Yes, this is a cover-up, and this document here is a lie. What happened on that day was 300 women marched to Parliament, and when they got to the House of Commons, they were faced with police brutality on a scale they'd never experienced before. There was a six-hour onslaught against the women. They were battened, they were beaten, women were sexually assaulted, they were groped and pinched. And this went on for hour after hour, So there was a huge attempt to cover up what had actually happened to the women that day. And that's why this document here is a complete lie.
Emily was caught up in the controversial events surrounding Black Friday. The following day, she was arrested for breaking two windows inside the House of Commons. And she wasn't alone. After this latest betrayal, the radicals felt they had nothing to lose. Violent militancy escalated. But those opposed to the campaign felt unrestrained too. It wasn't unusual for angry male mobs to manhandle the enemy. In the early years, direct action had meant window breaking, heckling meetings, and chaining oneself to railings. Now, a new militancy that included fire raising and bombings was seen as the only answer.
If I gave you three words to describe the militant side of the suffragettes, would you reject or accept campaigners? Accept?
I'd accept that, yes.
Protesters?
Yes.
Accept. Terrorists?
Yeah, I wouldn't say terrorists. No, I wouldn't say that. But I think if we had, you know, certainly that's the way they were viewed by the press at the time. And I think, you know, perhaps if we even had our modern day press, that's how they would describe them. I think what's important to understand is how much vitriol the establishment felt about what these women were doing, the people that ran the big newspapers at the time, the people that ran the political parties, hated them very, very much.
By 1911, Emily Davison was looking for new ways of spreading the propaganda message. Increasingly, Parliament, the home of implacable opposition to votes for women, became her target. Already, she'd been banned twice from the Palace of Westminster. But Emily was now planning another protest. Ted Lloyd Jukes, the yeoman usher of the House of Lords, is taking me down into the bowels of the building to show me what Emily did next.
And this is part of the original building that, in the Great Fire of 1834, didn't get touched. And it dates back quite a long way.
It's used. And it just glows gold, doesn't it?
It was redecorated by the Victorians, but it's original Gothic. But we want to go through here. Round behind the organ, to what I call the most famous broom cupboard in the country. Now, go into that cupboard.
Yes.
And then look at what's on the back of the door. I can't get in there with you, as you will see, it's quite small.
In this broom cupboard, Emily Wilding Davison hid herself illegally. She was a brave suffragette campaigning for votes for women at a time when Parliament denied them that right. Notice placed here by Tony Benn MP.
Emily had already been banned from Parliament. And more significantly, as her latest protest took place when the 1911 census was recorded, her address that night would forever remain the Houses of Parliament.
This is very effective, doesn't hurt anybody, causes quite a lot of embarrassment to the government. Yes. And to security of the Palace of Westminster.
Yeah, smart lady from that point of view.
Not all of Emily's protests were as benign as this. She began to torch letterboxes. She was now part of a large network of freelance militants engaged in repeated acts of criminality. Suffragette militancy was now seen as a real threat to society. To find out how the government dealt with this menace, I've come to the National Archives in Kew to look at some of the top secret files on the suffragettes. My guide is Professor of Law at King's College London, Maliha Malik. Yeah.
Gosh, it says on this closed until 1965.
Yeah, that's when they were revealed quite late. Yeah.
Really?
Some of them weren't released till 2003 because
Why?
Of... I think they are quite controversial. I think that they do start to convey the force and power that was used by the government who made sure by this time the suffragettes were being imprisoned, they were being spied upon by the government, by special branch and by the police. So the extent of sheer power that was deployed against the suffragettes is something that I think very many people don't understand.
The files show that government increased the size of special branch and employed new technologies to spy on the women.
So the police wrote off at one point and to ask for the latest cameras, the latest, most powerful telescopic lenses. And they started increasingly taking photographs. And what we've got here is an early use of photography for police surveillance to create photographs for spying on the women, really. These photographs were taken on the street or some of them were actually taken in prison. And photograph 10 is particularly important because photograph 10 is a very interesting woman called Evelyn Manester. It looks as if she's standing there willingly. But if I show you another photograph, if you look at this photograph, this is the original photograph, we can see that there is a prison officer, probably, his arm is held around her neck to hold her head up so that she can actually be photographed.
That's amazing. She's not just being sort of held, here you go, have a photo. She's got a guy's arm around her neck to keep it straight. And no wonder she's making a funny face. Because you would. And it makes you start to doubt everything we take for granted, that we go, oh, yes, I know that about suffragettes, or I know that about Emily Davison. You start to think, what has been manipulated?
So I think that these decisions were being made at the highest levels of government. And at the time, I think that the establishment at the time was worried about political change. There was increasing industrial unrest just before World War I, and there were a whole range of different types of protest movements. So I think, to a certain extent, the suffragette movement can be seen as a part of that wider sort of challenge to the established political order.
Hundreds of suffragettes were arrested as a result of their activities. But their campaign didn't stop there. One of the government's biggest problems was dealing with the militants once they were imprisoned. Behind bars, Emily Davison would take her protest to a completely new level. In the lead-up to the First World War, the government imprisoned more than 1,000 militant suffragettes. Emily Davison went to prison 9 times for her cause, for offences that ranged from breaking windows to firebombing letterboxes. It's what happened to Emily in prison that set the course for her final dramatic act. I'm meeting Dr. Helen Pankhurst, the granddaughter of Sylvia, the most radical of the Pankhurst family. Sylvia, like Emily Davison, went to prison on several occasions. Once inside, the struggle didn't end. The suffragettes demanded that they be given the status of political prisoners. But to the government, they were common criminals. Emily, like many of the women, went on hunger strike to protest. The authorities' response was brutal, force feeding.
How does force feeding work?
What you do is you have some awful instruments of torture, and it was torture. The doctor and wardens would come into the cell, so you'd have 4, 5, 6 people holding you down. This lovely instrument would be used to force open the women's mouth, and
so in you go,
and then force out.
Out.
And then one of these would be put down, all the way down, hopefully into the right place and not into the lungs, because otherwise you've got major damage. But there was major damage that was done at the same time. And then things like milk, egg, brandy, sometimes all sorts of things would be put down, and you'd be forced to eat.
Did anyone die because of this?
There were a lot of complications. There were a lot of cases of people who, because of the force feeding, forever after had problems, heart problems and so on. My grandmother always had digestive problems afterwards from the force feeding.
In 1912, Emily Davison endured force feeding once again. This time as part of a mass protest. She wrote to her mother about what happened when the authorities broke their way into her cell.
A warden held each hand down on the arm of the chair,
gripped my head and began to force the tube down my nostril. That's the other point. As if the women struggled too much, it would go down their nostrils, causing even more damage. It hurt me very much.
A feeling of suffocation and sickness followed. It makes your throat start to constrict just reading it. Oh, God, and that is going down the nostril.
The nostril.
Oh.
And also think about this. It's not just all of this being put down you once. It's twice a day, day in, day out.
Surrounded by the anguished screams of her fellow hunger strikers, this was the moment when Emily Davison crossed a line. It was the first intimation that she was prepared to risk her life for the cause. In a desperate act, she threw herself over a prison balcony and down some stairs, cracking her skull and bruising her ribs. That night, the prison authorities force-fed her yet again.
So cold in that cell. And, you know, after a while, all you can think about is how cold you are. And imagine being in there and not eating and being even colder because you have nothing to protect you. And being frustrated and being angry and being scared. And it was interesting, Helen, talking about the psychological impact of the force feeding because of the build-up to it, because of hearing them coming and hearing the screams from your friends and colleagues. Pretty horrific. And Emily Davison is one of these women who is not being heard, who, whatever she does, is feeling that they're not getting anywhere. So she reaches a point where only the most public act of protest, only the most extreme act of defiance will do. She needs headlines. She needs big, big headlines. So where do you go? You go to the biggest event of the lot.
And the biggest event of the lot in 1913 was Derby Day. Hundreds of thousands of people took the day off work and headed for Epsom Downs. It was one of the few occasions where all social classes mixed together. Dukes rubbed shoulders with dustmen. Royalty was separated from the hoi polloi by just the width of a racetrack. The king and queen arrived to see their horse, Anma, in the big race. Emily knew that the eyes of the world and the lenses of the newsreel cameramen would be focused on Epsom. Thousands took the train from Victoria Station, and that's where I'm joining historian Elizabeth Crawford. Emily bought a return ticket that day. It's always been used as evidence that she wasn't on a suicide mission.
We know that there's the return stub of the train ticket. Ah. Now, what's your feeling on that?
Well, I've done quite a lot of research on train services, and Derby Day was different from any other day because they suspended normal services, and I'm sure these must have been return-only, special rate trains.
That's the first time I've had the return ticket explained. Because I couldn't get that. People say, oh, she clearly didn't think she was going to die or she didn't intend to commit suicide. She had a return ticket.
Yes.
But if that's the only kind of ticket you could buy, then of course she did. Do you think Emily Davison was acting alone? Just her idea and she executed it alone?
Well, I believe she acted entirely alone. I don't think there was anybody else involved. The day before was the very first day of a big Women's Social and Political Union summer festival in Kensington, and she was definitely there. And there was also a statue of Joan of Arc, and Emily Davison is placed there with her comrade Mary Lee standing in front of this statue, and the mention of the Derby did come up, and, you know, just to the fact that it was the next day. But I think that perhaps that evening at the fair, the idea was put in her mind. I don't think she'd planned ahead of it.
In the months before the Derby, government crackdowns incited the suffragettes into a frenzy of militancy. Emmeline Pankhurst, the leader of the WSPU, openly incited the militants to rebellion. She exhorted them to be militant, each in your own way. Those of you who can break windows, break them. Those of you who can still further attack the sacred idol of property, do so. Elizabeth wants to show me just how extreme the militants' actions were becoming by the summer of 1913.
I have never seen this before. This is the Suffragette. This is their own
paper,
newspaper. This is only about a month before the Derby.
Yes.
And when you look at the various stories in here, train fired at Teddington, explosion in Manchester Free Trade Hall, beware dangerous bomb, railway coach in flames. And there is a lot happening.
Yes.
And a lot of it involves fire.
Yeah.
And we know that Emily Davison started various fires, didn't she?
Yes, so it was all sort of building up to a crescendo.
After 9 prison sentences, weakened by hunger striking and 49 episodes of force feeding, Emily was perhaps coming to believe that one final desperate act might produce a result. Elizabeth has brought along a passage that Emily wrote in 1912. It crystallises her state of mind.
The glorious and inscrutable spirit of liberty has but one further penalty in its power, the surrender of life itself. To lay down life for friends, that is glorious, selfless, inspiring. But to reenact the tragedy of Calvary for generations yet unborn, that is the last and consummate sacrifice of the militant. Nor will she shrink from this nirvana. She will be faithful to the last. And the last words conjure up the image of Joan of Arc, who was very much, by this stage, the WSPU sort of saint.
So she's seen the statue the night before the Derby. She's, one could argue, infused with the spirit of Joan of Arc.
Yes.
We know that she has stated she's prepared to die for the cause. We know that she's done things that could have seriously injured her. And that she's always had this sort of... you know the bit in your brain that stops you from... jumping out in front of cars or horses. I wonder if there's a point at which if you push that more than once, you lose it.
Yes, I could quite see that, yes.
Emily's militancy had been all-consuming, and now with a prison record, she was broke and unemployable. A radicalised woman with nothing to lose, championing a cause with everything to gain, was about to commit an act that would be seared into our sporting and social history. I now know why Emily was at the Derby. With the help of the forensics team, I'm hoping to uncover what she intended to do there. On a beautiful June day in 1913, Emily Wilding Davison was just another face in the crowd at the Epsom Derby. By that evening, she was infamous. The image of her colliding with the King's horse and tumbling through the air was already showing in London cinemas. But as the horses galloped away from the start line, what was going through Emily Davison's mind? Potential suicide or accidental martyr. 100 years on, I'm hoping we can finally settle the argument. It's time to see if the forensics team have uncovered anything new. They have several strands of evidence. And they're going to start by showing me the footage that has been specially restored. It shows a remarkable angle in amazing clarity that I've never seen before.
I'm watching her. And she goes, wow, oh my word. That is an amazing
angle, you can see so much more there, because if you just watch her. Just go back a bit, just go back a bit. You know, I thought that the horse, just go back two more frames. I thought the horse couldn't see her because she was right in front of it. In fact, she's just to the right, and I think he tries to jump her. He pricks his ears, and you watch his front feet come off the ground. Do you see? He's actually trying to jump her. I mean, that's just staggering.
For 100 years, the received view in the horse racing world has been that it was complete chance that Emily collided with the king's horse. But using the three camera angles, the team has pinpointed Emily's position on the course. Remarkably, it's much closer to the start of the bend than has always been accepted. This introduces an intriguing possibility that Emily did have a clear view of the runners.
What's her line of vision to Anna, the king's horse?
We think it's quite substantial. That's why we believe she has actually targeted the king's horse quite clearly.
Emily had only 4 seconds between ducking under the rail and being bowled over. Was that enough time to identify the king's colours?
That's obviously when they first turn the camera and see the horse, but if you watch when Emily ducks, I think that's probably the first time she could actually have a clear line of sight.
Mm-hmm. She absolutely worked out the place on the course to suit her needs the best, but also to have all the cameras on her.
She was in absolutely the right position to do what she intended to do.
And finally, after 100 years, it might be possible to reveal what Emily's intentions actually were. The restored footage shows that she is holding something.
And you can see she's got something in her hands. She's lifting it up.
I've just circled the object that Emily appears to have in her hand. Just run that through in real time.
It's hard to tell what it is, but she's definitely trying to pass it or present it.
Mm. I think present is a good word.
She's wanting to show something, and she's just caught at the one angle that would bring the horse down and give her injuries that were ultimately fatal.
Emily was taken to the Cottage Hospital in Epsom. She never came out of the coma into which she had fallen, and she died 4 days later. The coroner's verdict was accidental death. Emily Davison was never able to reveal her intentions, but now our forensic examination has highlighted something in her hands that provides an explanation. It seems to me she wasn't trying to bring down the king's horse at all. She was hoping to attach something to it. But what happened to that item? Nothing in the police inventory of Emily's possessions matches the description of what appears to be a scarf. But there is one thing that may just be the object Emily had in her hand. Appropriately, I'm back at the Houses of Parliament. It has in its possession a scarf that was acquired by writer Barbara Gorner.
Is this actually it?
Yes. I bought it at auction. It was up for sale at Sotheby's.
Who was bidding against you?
The Jockey Club, which is not for the faint-hearted.
But that's very good for you, because it shows the Jockey Club thought it was the real deal. And it belonged to Frances Annie Burton, who says her father was a clerk of the course at Epsom on that day.
He ran onto the course, and lying close by her was the sash. So he picked it up and put it in his pocket. He then actually forgot about it, I suppose, until her funeral. And he had a daughter. So he actually wrapped his baby daughter in it, took her in the funeral procession, and put the scarf back in the drawer. The daughter kept the sash. And it didn't come to light until it was sold to pay nursing home fees.
If this is the scarf, what does Barbara think Emily Davison was doing with it?
You can actually see she's got it grasped in her left hand here, look.
Yeah.
Because I think it was folded then, because it's a very fine scarf and it's silk. So if she did that with it, as yes. you did that sash, it would unfurl. The women believed they hadn't got a voice because they didn't have a vote. There is a rule under civil law that a subject can actually petition the king. So she needed to get to the king, but obviously she was a renowned militant, so couldn't get anywhere near him unless she did it through mischievous means or clever means. And that she waited for the king's racehorse because she wanted the king's horse to go past the winning post wearing the Votes for Women colours. And it would have been a great publicity stunt. Because she's standing determined. She does not look like a woman about to kill herself, let's face it.
Oh, no, no, no.
Absolutely not. What I do feel is that she misjudged it and didn't realise how fast a moving horse is actually going.
Well, that was amazing. And for me, that really solves the final piece of the mystery, because I was pretty convinced by that, partly because of the fact that it's quite a short chain. You know, that it is one woman in whose possession it was. It belonged to her father, and he was a clerk of the course at Epsom, or he was working at Epsom on that day. The other thing that convinces me is the jockey club bid for it at auction. Why would they have bothered if that wasn't the real deal, if that wasn't the item? And the third thing is just a gut feeling. It just feels right. Barbara is clearly convinced by it and has become captivated by Emily Wilding Davison as a character. She believes it. She paid good money to get that scarf. And I just think it's so incredibly appropriate that it now hangs here in the Houses of Parliament.
Herbert Jones, the jockey, made a full recovery from the minor injuries he sustained, but he never again reached the heights he'd achieved in his professional career. And he also never forgot Emily Davison. He was said to be haunted by her face. He ultimately took his own life in 1951. Emily Davison's death provoked a complex reaction that still felt today. I've come to the Women's Library to look at the hate mail Emily received while she lay dying. Liz Chapman is the Director of Library Services.
Miss Davison, I am glad to hear you are in hospital. I hope you suffer torture until you die, you idiot, underlined. I consider you are a person unworthy of existence in this world and should like the opportunity of starving and beating you to a pulp. Why don't your people find an asylum for you? Yours, an Englishman. Wow.
I mean, I suppose, fortunately, in a way, she wasn't conscious, so she wouldn't have seen it.
Half of the world embraced the myth of the reckless madwoman. But the suffragette leadership immediately recognised the propaganda value of Emily's sacrifice. Her funeral, organised by the Women's Social and Political Union, contained all the pomp of a state occasion. Thousands of suffragettes accompanied the coffin. Tens of thousands of people lined the streets of London. Emily had become what she perhaps desired and what the movement needed, the first martyr for the cause. After a service in Bloomsbury, her coffin was taken by train to the family grave in Morpeth, Northumberland.
A massive group of people from the northeast and suffragette supporters came with the funeral procession, but out of respect to the family and to give them privacy, they waited here. And Emily's coffin was taken in with just her family and friends.
On the centenary of her death, the process of reclaiming Emily as a heroine of the suffragette movement is being reenacted by another generation.
Sing Emily, sing liberty. Your name will remain and we never will forget your bravery. In the fight for equality, Emily inspires us yet.
The community of Morpeth is planning a major commemoration. The grave was recently refurbished with a lottery grant. It's still a place of pilgrimage to honour the struggle for women's rights.
Women are not free while men only make the laws. Emily inspires us yet. Sing Emily.
But in 1914, Emily Davison's sacrifice was marginalised by much bigger events. The start of the First World War brought an end to the suffragette campaign. Emmeline Pankhurst immediately suspended militancy so that women could mobilise in the factories and the fields. When the war ended, the reward was limited women's suffrage, extended in 1928 to finally give women the same voting rights as men.
I grew up in a racing world, in a family that was obsessed by the Derby, for whom the Derby was sacrosanct. So in my childhood, Emily Davison was a madwoman who had thrown herself in front of the King's Horse, who had tried to disrupt the greatest flat race of them all. And it's been such an extraordinary adventure to discover more about her, about what she stood for, about the suffragette movement. And I still think it's one of the most remarkable things I've ever seen. But I think it is hugely significant as a moment in history, a moment that absolutely sums up the desperation of women in this country who wanted the vote. They just wanted democracy. They wanted what you and I now take for granted and what so many of us don't even bother to do when it comes to election time. And that act of sacrifice is still remembered today on the centenary of her death. And here, the grave of Emily Davison is decorated with the suffragette colours, because she was the ultimate suffragette.